I'm the volunteer. I received a March Civic Fellowship this summer to intern with an organization called New South Richmond. They're a small local nonprofit that works with refugees throughout their settlement period. The title of my presentation is Richmond and Refugees, Divided Personal Narratives in the Resettlement Community. I'll delve into this deeper a little more further in the presentation. I just want to give you an idea that this is what I was focusing on, personal stories, how those play into the resettlement community. I'm going to talk first a little bit about what the organization itself does, then I'm going to talk about what I did while I was there, and then I will talk about how I integrated my experience there with what I've learned here at the university. What did I do this summer? As I said, I worked with Reestablish Richmond. They are a small nonprofit, they're local here, and they fill in some of the gaps that are left by the federal resettlement agencies, either because they do not have funding to cover certain things or because their funding is limited to a 60 to 90 day period, and after that they're not supposed to help. That's where Reestablish Richmond steps in. Their mission is helping refugees establish roots, build community, and become self-sufficient. There's a lot of different ways they do this. Just to give you a quick snapshot, this picture here is of a flyer for an event that happened in the first or second week of my internship, right around World Refugee Day. It was a community resource fair where organizations from all over Richmond came in. They had tables. There was information about education, employment, housing, healthcare, community groups that people might not be aware of otherwise. So that's just a little bit about what they do. While I was there, I was the Refugee Outreach Program Assistant, which meant that I was helping the main Refugee Outreach Program Coordinator, most of the contact with clients, although it's a very small nonprofit, so everyone does a lot of that. So I did client visits. We would go into people's homes, do intakes, talk to them, get a little sense of what their lives were like, what they needed from us, where our services could be most helpful to them. DMV advocacy would go with people to the DMV, take them there, help them get through the paperwork, make sure everything was set up right for them to take tests so they could get their learner's permit, et cetera. Very difficult system to navigate for someone who speaks English, let alone someone who's not completely fluent. I would take people to social services appointments, help them go to the social worker, get the paperwork sorted out for their child care so that they could go to work to get the benefits that they needed to. And then also doing volunteer introductions. So Reestablish Richmond has a really large volunteer base, and bringing volunteers who were matched with clients, introducing them to the clients, and figuring out setting goals and expectations for what they would be doing with those clients, and making sure that relationship got off to a good start. This picture here is me helping one of our clients. I helped her and her family fill out applications for green cards so you can sort of see how people will progress, people need different things at different times, and Reestablish really meets people where they are. So Reestablish Richmond serves refugees from all over the place. The majority right now come from Afghanistan. There's about 70% of them. They're here on special immigrant visas, which means that they help the U.S. Army or the U.S. Embassy back in Afghanistan, and now their families are in danger because of it. So that's how they are here. They're not the only population, but this sort of gives you a sense of the population I was interacting with, and that's something that translates directly back into my academics. I'm an anthropology and Arabic double major. I changed it since it was on your program, so. and I got to serve with other Arabic-speaking populations, which was incredibly rewarding to use my language and get to practice that. And then anthropology, one of the biggest things that I've gotten out of anthropology is the power of positive cross-cultural communication. I think that's really important, not only for this work, but any type of work that you're trying to do with people who are different from you, and everyone's different from you. So that, I think, is very important, and I saw that play out every day in my internship. Clients interacting with clients interacting with the people who worked with Reestablish Richmond. Resettlement workers interacting with clients. Resettlement workers interacting between organizations. So this is sort of what was spurring my thought process thinking throughout my internship. I initially started out with a question about what kind of cultural challenges do refugees face specifically in Richmond. And I quickly realized this wasn't the right question to be asking. It was far too broad to analyze, and I also wasn't really getting pulled one direction or another. And I really started to think about personal stories. I would hear my coworkers talk about how some families people will respect them a lot more because they portrayed themselves a certain way or they told their stories this way versus a different way. And this sort of got me thinking, like, what roles do narrative plays? What do people do with those narratives when they hear them? And why are these narratives important? So this is what I set out to explore. And I did this through in-depth ethnographic interviews. I interviewed my coworkers at Reestablish Richmond, I interviewed other resettlement workers, and then community and volunteers. Volunteers and community members. I asked them open-ended questions, I was trying to elicit stories, really get people's personal perspectives of how they interacted with refugee narratives and what they meant to them and what they thought about them. Narratives emerged not only as the theme of my experience, but also throughout the interviews. These were the kinds of things that came out in the interviews. First of all, people tell personal stories. They tell you about their home, their family, what life was like back wherever they came from, and what life is like for them now. They compare the two. What food they used to eat, what their house looked like, which family members are here or there. Those very personal stories. Another thing that emerged was refugee stories don't just come out overnight. You don't just walk up to somebody, introduce yourself, and they tell you all the things that have happened to them. Every refugee has been through incredible trauma, and they had to tell their stories many times throughout the process that got them here to the United States. It's a very rigorous step-by-step process, and there's many times that they get interviewed and have to tell those stories, and it can be really painful. So those refugee narratives don't come out without trust. And trust is something that Reestablish Richmond really tries to build. They go to the client's homes. They meet them where they are. They make them feel comfortable, meet them literally at their home so that they feel more open and trusting, and that's a theme that they try to continue throughout the relationships with their clients. Now lastly, refugee narratives elicit reactions. When somebody tells you a story, you feel something. I remember one day I was driving a family to the daycare center. They were going to visit to see if they were going to be happy if their kids were going to go there. And I'm sitting there, and the husband sitting next to me in the passenger seat, and his wife and his two kids are in the back. He starts telling me about how he has a friend who got beheaded by the Taliban and how he has other family that's been threatened, and all of these terrible things. And I was driving, so I couldn't, there wasn't much I could do, but I wanted to elicit, say, sorry, I'm sorry, even though that might not mean the same thing to him that it means to me, it still makes you feel something very strongly, and that was one moment that I wanted that happened. With the things that I experienced, both in my internship and then also the information that I got from my interviews, I came to a conclusion that seems kind of obvious, but refugee narratives have value. That might seem simple and not that important, but the reality is that refugees are often cast as helpless people. They're speechless, they need charity, they don't have anything to bring to the table. The reality is that's not the case. Their narratives are what they bring to the table, their stories, what's happened to them, their lives, their people. And so the narratives have social value, and that value doesn't necessarily fall into a category that we think of when we hear the word value. It's not monetary, it's not tangible, but it's a social value. And those narratives do cultural work. And these are the different things, the three main things that I came up with. They have emotional value. As I mentioned, when someone tells you a story, that makes you feel something. And so people talked about how it made them feel grateful. Wow, I've lived such a privileged life. I've never had to go through something. Wow, how did that person get through that? That's incredible. And then a sense of interconnectedness, like, oh, they're a person, just like me. Secondly, educational value. People talked about how it was enabled them to learn about other cultures, other experiences. And then not only does that enable the person who hears the story, that person who hears the story can go tell someone else. If you're talking to someone and they say, oh, the Syrian refugee crisis, I saw this article, or I watched this news story, and then you can say, oh, I met this family, and this man used to have two businesses back in Syria, and now here he is struggling to get one job. And those sorts of stories personalize something that you don't get in the media with vast news coverage. It brings it really home, it humanizes it. And that's really why you get refugee narratives challenging perceptions. They challenge the perceptions that refugees are helpless or speechless or only need charity. It challenges those racist and those ethnocentric perceptions that we have about refugees, helps us better understand who these people are, where they come from, why they're here, what they've been through, what life is like for them here and at home. And as I said, it establishes a human connection. And ultimately, I think that's the most important thing that I came out of my internship with and my project. That those narratives are what They're valuable not only between the people that hear, tell them and hear them, but the people, the community around them, the resettlement community, and then the wider community of our nation and also our globe. And I think that that is really essential to remember when we talk about these crises, that there are people behind them and those people have stories and those stories have value.
Somebody
says
we're not doing questions, so
thank you. Fitting that I went there right before I came.